All right, so I'm here with Dan Hill. Dan Hill is the president owner of Sensory Logic, and that is a company that specifically does facial coding for people that are interested to know what emotions are evoked by a product that they have, whether it be a commercial or anything like that. So how you doing today, Dan?
I'm doing well. Thanks, Chris.
Excellent. I appreciate the fact that you were able to take a little bit of time out of your schedule to come meet and hang out and look at the lab that we are currently doing research with Dan. I can't tell you any more about that. I can just say that we are. And I was showing you the rooms that we do the testing in, where you get your video clips that I edit together for you.
Sure.
Which are masterfully done, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, I deserve
the best ever.
Thank you.
Yes.
And you're good. You are good. So you studied under Paul Ekman.
Yes.
And Paul Ekman is pretty much known as a pioneer in facial coding. How did you get hooked up with him to begin with?
I'm a very lucky man in life. So this is the exact sequence, which I normally don't go into, but maybe it makes for an interesting story. So someone at IBM sends over an article from American Demographics, now deceased Cornell University publication, talking about the breakthroughs and the implications for all of us. They were mostly intuitive, emotional decision makers. I'm a former poet. I say, I have no problem with that. It makes sense to me. We're not supremely rational. I also happen to look at the tabloids in the grocery store. I do not see a lot of rational people being depicted there. Mm-hmm. That sent me on a hunt then for how I was going to be able to capture and quantify those emotional responses. So the first link in the chain is actually Charles Darwin. Darwin was the first scientist to take emotions seriously, and Darwin came to realize that in your face you best reflect and communicate your emotions. Now, my problem was Darwin wasn't exactly available for a conversation, so I'm going to have to find somebody else.
Well, you couldn't do a seance?
Well, I thought about it. Okay. You know? I mean, I wasn't that far. I mean, I was in San Diego. I wasn't so far from Shirley MacLaine. I mean, I thought about tooling up the road to L.A. and seeing what I could do. But I got a bit luckier because if I just tooled a bit further up the road in San Francisco, it was indeed Paul Ekman. Now, Paul has been cited by Time magazine as one of the 100 most influential people on the planet. And if I understand the story correctly, Paul got into this by chance just as much as I did. A colleague had a grant to go out and prove that Charles Darwin was all wet, that Margaret Mead was right, that everything's culturally relative, thank you very much. And Paul, like any good scientist, went out and he listened to the data. And the data said, whoa, wait a minute, you know, this Darwin guy, he's not all wet. Mm-hmm. I mean, emotions have an evolutionary advantage for us. They give us extra information. The face is the only place in the body where the muscles attach right to the skin. Darwin needed to refine it a bit, but basically it's there.
So to put a finer point on it, he pretty much showed the universality of
emotions. He did show the universality and the spontaneity of it.
Okay.
And the abundance. No other species has more facial muscles than human beings.
Okay.
So you got universality, spontaneity, and abundance. That's a pretty good starting point.
Yes.
Then Ekman refined it. He took this grant that got flipped to him by chance. Mm-hmm. He worked, he codified it. He worked with a colleague at the School of Medicine in San Francisco over about 15 years, and he figured out which muscle movements correspond to which motions, called the facial action coding system.
Yes, FAC, facts?
Yes, facts. That's okay. His little pun.
Okay.
Yes.
So
you get the facts from the face because actions speak louder than words.
I never even thought of that as a homonym for facts.
Yes.
So
professors are not always famous for having a good sense of humor.
Corny. Sometimes it's a little corny.
A little corny indeed.
So one of the things that he did was he took pictures of himself and his postdocs making certain emotional faces. He brought them to parts of the world, showed them to them.
That's true.
To the people there, and asked them to tell him what emotion it was. And then vice versa, he asked the people to make certain emotional expressions, took pictures of it, and brought them back home.
Yes.
So that was one of the things that he did to determine that culture doesn't have as much to do with facial expression as the universality and the evolution of emotions.
Yes. And that famous, most famous place that he went to, now he's a man who's published, 300 articles, 16 books. Mm-hmm. New Guinea's where he went. He wanted a place that had never been exposed to Western culture. So he trooped up into the highlands in the mid to maybe late 60s. I'm guessing about 65, 67 to do the work. So that's...
And if you see the original pictures of Ekman making these faces, you know it's the 60s. Big mutton chops.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's rather amusing at times. So Paul did the work. Then I got lucky because I knew someone at Northwestern University who was a friend with Paul, and he got me the meeting. So to say I studied under Paul is probably a little bit of an exaggeration. What happens, I went to Paul, said, you know, there's an old joke in advertising, half my dollar's wasted, don't know which half. My father happened to have been a 3M executive.
Okay.
He wasn't interested in wasting his money. Mm-hmm. I haven't met a lot of people who are. And I said, I believe if I get a more intimate, more accurate read on people, then I can help lots of folks. Mm-hmm. And then, frankly, I have a lot of interest outside of pure business, but, you know, I'm in business. So I learned it from Paul. I mean, I probably had some advantages. I lived in Italy as a boy. I didn't know the language at first, so I had to read nonverbals.
Okay.
My mom was an interior designer. She took me around to the art museums of Europe. I was in love with Rembrandt by the age of 7.
Nice.
I have a very famous relative, Clint Hill, who was a facial coder. He's the man who jumped on the back of the limousine in Dallas in 63 to try to save Kennedy.
Mm.
So, you know, by hook or crook, I seem to come about this as a profession without realizing it would be my profession.
Now, Paul Ekman used to, correct me if I'm wrong, he used to train in a mirror to isolate the muscle movement for the, you know, because when you're coding, you're looking at specific parts of, like, the orbital area or the mouth or stuff like
yes,
that.
Yes, it's very precise. You're talking 43 muscles in the face, and if he couldn't do it that way, he'd use an electric shock on the muscle to, you know,
to stimulate
to trigger it.
Because the facts, I don't know if it still is, but I think that it used to have like individual pictures of the exact muscle that he's talking about being raised or lowered, and he, you know, like pictures of that, and it's him.
Yes.
Making.
Oh yes. Yeah. These
or
are
his,
all
or his postdocs or.
No, mostly him.
It's mostly him.
More recently, it's his daughter.
Oh. Okay.
Who's a bit better looking than maybe he was with the mutton chops.
it's not a hard thing to reach. Anyway.
Yeah, it's a 500-page manual.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the easiest thing to get through, but it's a wonderful Bible. I mean, we made refinements. We took it past that to really make it work for a business. We kept to the essence of it, but we had to make refinements and movements that would let us get it done, so that, you know, it wasn't 12 years before we turned in the report for our clients.
Just so you know, you're doing it from a business perspective. From a psychology, experimental psychology perspective, facial coding is used in many different ways.
Oh, absolutely.
One of them has to do with EMG, because, of course, you know, fear is a raised brow, has a raised brow component, whereas disgust kind of has a lowered brow component. And there are people that have shown, there are articles published, actually by somebody who used to be a postdoc here, that, you know, the smell... somebody who is experiencing the body odor of somebody who is in a state of fear has more raised eyebrow activation. And when they're smelling the body odor of somebody who is in the process of being disgusted, not that they are disgusting, they replicate it. So there seems to be a emotional contagion component having to do with olfaction, which is an interesting field in and of itself. But getting back to facial coding, the resiliency of facial expressions is actually used as an endpoint in psychological research, and I think
as well it should be.
I totally agree, but it's a testament to how powerful it is and how accepted it is. I don't think that research would have been done pre-1960.
No, I don't think so. I mean, really everyone was accepting that it was culturally relative, and please stay away from saying that there's an underlying template, but there is an underlying template. Darwin did his initial work, which is really drawn from letters and correspondence and some observations. I mean, Ekman's traveled the world to do it. We've tested around large portions of the world. So we've seen it in action. When I went to China, my guide the first day said, oh, you won't be able to read the Chinese people. We're inscrutable. Well, they mentioned that comment just after they had shown extreme sadness on their face because they were talking about the building cranes in Shanghai.
Mm.
They were a native. It's a very crowded city, to say the least, with more and more buildings going up. Profound sadness. Clearly, they were someone I could read who was not, you know, inscrutable.
That is interesting.
I could go to the art museum in Shanghai, which was a lovely museum, and look at a pottery vase from the 8th century. I can see how the emperor is feeling based on how he's depicted by the artist. So it's just simply not true.
Is there ever a time when you turn that filter off?
I try, but then I'm suddenly at a party and I see an interesting expression across the room and I wonder what was just said. I'm watching a made-for-TV movie and the acting more times than not is horrible. And I'm going, oh, no, my God, that's not really that emotion.
Mm-hmm.
So semi-turn off is about as far as I get.
I get you. Now, you had mentioned to me previously that in training the people that work for you that do coding... it's some are a better fit than others. Absolutely, you said that absolutely. People with an artistic flair seem to be better at this than non-artistic people.
Yes, my first coder was a woman who had written her PhD on facial coding. She might have been book smart for it. She did not have visual acuity. She was quickly surpassed by both my master coder and myself. In Todd's case, extremely good. He was a sculptor of the human face, working in wood as his medium when I hired him in, and a psych major in college. It's hard to beat that. Another coder is a daughter of two painters, for instance. Mm. So yes, visual acuity is a nice thing. Core of the brain, of course, devoted to processing visuals. So we're an extremely, as you well know, sensory and emotional being.
Oh, yeah.
Origin of the brain, as you well know, a small note atop the spinal column.
Now, speaking of art, artistry, if you will, and facial coding, I mean, Disney has kind of really taken advantage of that. Like, I think the secret to Disney movies was that everybody always had an emotional expression, even when they weren't the focus of the scene or the person talking, whatever. And now with the computer animation, I mean, you know, whatever, you buy Finding Nemo, and you have the behind the scenes thing where they show you how they do it. They almost have facial coding down as good as researchers so that they can get the most emotive impact from whatever the scene is trying to draw out of people.
Which is natural, because this is the first company where, you know, Walt said to them, you know, we don't build a product, we actually build an emotion. It's called happiness, and that's what we're selling. So, you know, it's a pretty...
That's not aiming high at all.
Yeah, that's not aiming high at all. Happiest place on earth, except for certain stockholder meetings that have not always been the happiest place on earth. But yeah, they're pretty adept at emotions, by and large. But Walt had that fantastic concentration on details. I mean, he would get down on his knees on Main Street and say, what's the kid's perspective? What's the six-year-old see that I, as an adult walking down Main Street, wouldn't pick up?
Oh.
I mean, he'd look at the backside of a stop sign and say, well, they're going to see the front side from this direction. From that side, they're going to see the backside. What does the backside give them as an experience? There are few executives who would do that. Now, so in a Disney movie, that they would pay attention to the background characters, not those foregrounded, that's that extra attention to detail that gives you quality.
Yes.
It might seem superfluous, but it actually enriches the experience.
Oh, I definitely agree. Yeah. And I think Finding Nemo was like the first time that I noticed that they were just rocking the facial expressions where like the person who was in charge of X scene for Nemo, the main character, and they were listening to, who was it? Ellen DeGeneres is the voice for that character, I think. And, you know, it's very emotive. He literally has a mirror up next to his monitor and he's like emoting into it and like, you know, copying down on the screen what he's seeing in the mirror. So, I mean, so since Ekman was able to articulate, if you will, the facial expressions that he talks about, is that something that you had to practice to get, like, a hands-on understanding of it?
It actually wasn't that hard for me. I'm not sure why. But, I mean, I met with Ekman. I got his manual. I took it home. And pretty much at the end of a long weekend, I mean, I'm talking about like 40 hours of work probably, because I was fascinated as well. And I would say basically the end of that weekend, I felt like I knew what I had, and then it was how do I convert it into, you know, business practice. But, you know, I've used this in politics. We have a piece coming out in the New Yorker online on our use of this in sports this week.
Okay.
I mean, there's lots of places where this can fit.
Now, I'm going to try to pull together several different things that we've already been talking about.
Sure.
One of them has to do with...
good luck.
Yeah. Are you ready for this? One of them has to do, obviously, with the facial expressions of emotions. One of them has to do with politics. Mm-hmm. And one of them has to do with research by a student of Paul Rozin's, Jonathan Haidt, who recently... I recently read a news article where he did... I think that he did a study, or a study supported his idea that people that express, I might be getting this wrong, so I have to paraphrase, people who have a stronger reaction of disgust lean politically one way more than another.
Okay.
Right? I think they're more conservative.
I would expect more conservative.
Okay. That kind of dips into Paul Rozin's research about disgust, the evolution of disgust, and how it has kind of morphed into a moral disgust or social disgust, where obviously nothing toxic is entering our olfactory or gustatory inputs.
Sure.
It's just visual or auditory input that makes us feel disgusted because it rails against our morality.
Yeah.
Right? So in doing facial coding, do you see any, as somebody who only has their filter half on at best, or sure. partially off at sure. best, do you see that in your interactions with people, where when, let's say you're talking about something, maybe it's even with a good friend, and it's kind of a fringe topic, you know, that one of the topics you wouldn't discuss in public at a
sure.
bar.
Sure, sure.
Do you notice a disgust reaction from them?
If
they disagree with what you're talking about?
Sure, because to rephrase what you said a moment ago, disgust can be literal, bad taste, bad smell, but it can also be metaphorical.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that idea smells bad to me. That moral behavior, that behavior based on my having different moral standard, tastes bad to me.
Mm-hmm.
So no, I think that when you get into value system, which for me is when it gets exciting, because when you get to someone's value system, that's something they really can't retreat from.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think if you ask someone who's their hero and why, and you get an honest answer, you're a long ways down the road to knowing who that person is.
Interesting.
And so I love that as a question when we do work in sports, for instance. But you usually get the answer of my high school coach, and then that's really boring. But if you can push him on to something beyond that, then I think it's a bit more interesting. So no, I definitely agree. And to your point of a moment ago, from what I've read, which I don't always have time to go as deeply into these as I'd like, because I'm fascinated. In politics, yes, I would expect that someone who's conservative likes hierarchy, typically.
Mm-hmm.
They like status quo. They are oriented toward the past and tradition. So that which is new, they're going to have something of an aversive reaction to, by and large. Now, that's not always true. Giuliani was a conservative,
mm-hmm.
but he was fairly flamboyant. Mm-hmm. So I don't think he had an aversion to doing new things.
In more ways than one.
Yeah, in more ways than one. So I don't think he had an aversion to trying something new. We haven't had a lot of people in the mayor's office in New York who dressed up, you know, in dresses,
mm-hmm.
for instance.
Mm-hmm.
Probably not a lot of people after him will imitate that, the male persuasion. And a liberal will tend to be more open to experiences, therefore probably less likely to have a disgust reaction, because disgust really came about from a survival basis. If I eat that berry repeatedly and it tastes bad and I get sick, I should really stay away from it.
Mm-hmm.
So disgust really is the opposite end of the spectrum from being an open, exploratory person.
Now, just to digress for a second,
sure.
based on what you just said.
Should we digress on the digression?
Let's digress on the digression of the digression. Okay. Let's just make this turtles all the way down.
Okay.
The main taste component that triggers disgust is bitter.
Okay.
Right?
You'll be more the expert than me, but I'll listen.
Okay. But don't you think that over time and through culture, we've been able to accept things that are bitter in a way that kind of goes against this idea that, you know, bitter in nature usually equaled toxin, which equaled death or sickness. You know what I mean? Like beer, coffee, anything like that, you know, grapefruits
sure.
or what have you.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think we've gone so far as to like the dirt samples in Death Valley. but short of that, yes, I think we've adapted and found some pleasure in the variety, or certainly the kick that coffee mm-hmm. gives people.
Oh, yeah.
So sure, there's lots of ways we could make amendments. I think the basic thing was, if this fruit literally killed me, hopefully there's something in my body that reminds me next time that I almost died
mm-hmm.
from stomach ulcers after taking it.
But I also think that the fact that it is developmental demonstrates the nurture versus nature part of that, right? Because children, if
sure.
you feed them beer or or coffee, they will make a disgust face.
Yeah.
Like it's the worst thing you put in their mouth.
No, human beings are amazingly adaptive. And so those things can happen indeed.
Yeah.
But we've tested down to 2-year-olds. For a food company, a packaged goods company,
gotcha.
on food sampling, actually.
Hmm.
Now, their mothers had to come along, of course, but we were able to pick up, at that age, for the food that they wanted to sell to them, where on that spectrum did they fall?
Now, there are...
Where could they find acceptance?
Now, when you do facial coding, are you focusing mostly on what are considered the garden variety emotions?
Are you
familiar with that?
Well, I rephrase them as the core emotions.
Okay.
Which would be happiness, anger, surprise, disgust, contempt, sadness, and fear. So there's 7. Now, Ekman started with 6.
Mm-hmm.
He added in contempt later on. There's some debate about that. But to me, it's a very valuable emotion, because if trust is the emotion of business, contempt is its opposite.
I don't trust you.
I don't respect you.
Now, some of those emotions are more complex than others, wouldn't you say? Like, even though they're core. Do you see contempt in a 2-year-old's face?
I don't know about 2-year-old, but I've seen it in a 4-year-old.
Okay.
I've seen it in politicians' faces.
they're about 2 years old mentally.
Well, right? I think that the you know, we don't really have the Democrats and Republicans. The dominant party in Congress is always the contempt party. And that, you know, because politicians show a lot of contempt. Now, whether that's back to themselves for the exaggerations they gave to get into office, whether that's how they feel about their colleagues, the media, the voters, having to raise so much money, I'm not sure which one it is, but there's a remarkable degree of contempt on quite a few politicians' faces.
That's interesting. So, to digress upon the digression.
Sure.
If we were to stick with the social. Discussed having to do with morality and what you brought up, which was values. Values are none more important than people that engage in the great debate, the religious landscape, people who are atheists or Christians or Muslims. And, you know, even within Christianity, you know, no true Scotsman, you know, I'm really a Christian, but they're not because they don't follow my version.
That does happen, yes.
So, has anybody approached you about any kind of research like that? That's not a very business-oriented question. It's more of, you know, being a nerd, psychology nerd, of course, it's more interesting to me in that respect.
No, I have not been funded for that. We have done work on a nonprofit basis for the USDA, looking at how to help kids overcome obesity and what kinds of prompts may get them to accept it more readily. I have been asked whether I'd be willing to go to Iraq and train the security officers. And I said, how about Kuwait? How would we meet in Kuwait instead? they didn't take me up on that, so I didn't go because my wife said, I like you with both legs.
Yeah, really?
Very much, so please don't go. So I have not been funded for that. I think it comes up in an inadvertent way when we are asked about do they trust the product? Do they trust the pronouncements that are coming? Because if you buy into a brand, I mean, this is stretching your question, but if you buy into a brand, it's an affiliation. Depending on the nature of the brand. Some are very functional commodity brands. Others like Apple. I mean, I watch in airports. And when the Apple owner opens their computer and the Apple glows, you can see that they're an apostle. I mean, you can see that they are satisfied with themselves. They are proud. They are happy. Uh-huh. It is like going to church. You know, there is no priest going down, you know, with the incense. But, you know, the high priest, Mr. Jobs, is there embodied in the spirit of opening it and seeing the glowing apple. I mean, it truly is, and they are in church. So that's about as close as I've gotten.
So to bring it back to, you know, when you're having conversations with friends that you might not have in public at a bar, religion being one of them, politics is the other, right? Regardless of where you stand on the religious landscape as far as belief and disbelief, do you have friends that you've had conversations with that hold a different position?
Of course.
That when talking about things because of their religious, not political, affiliation and values, you can sense their disgust at what the topic being discussed.
Yes, but I would actually, again, elaborate just a little bit. One is, I think disgust and contempt are first cousins. Okay. Because disgust is very visceral. You know, I don't like it, I reject it. It could be an us, them, your religion, not my religion, or, you know, I'm not religious, you are. Contempt adds an attitudinal flavor to it. So it's very much an aversive rejection emotion, but it adds in a little more almost semi-conscious to my mind. You know, I don't respect you, I find you beneath me. You may remember, if you've ever read Gladwell's bestseller Blink, that facial coatings used at the Love Lab at the University of Washington in Seattle. And with 15 minutes of videotape, a 90% accuracy rate of the couple will stay married. Now, we've used it on speed dating. We have 100% accuracy, whether the man or the woman wants a second conversation. Now, maybe they're not going, you know, metaphorically to the same church, but if they're going to get married, you know, they are indeed uniting in some belief system around that they can be a successful couple, how they're going to raise their children, and things like that. So it makes a lot of sense to me that contempt means I disassociate from the brand and then affiliation to the brand. I disassociate from the person in the relationship. I can disassociate from your moral viewpoint. So I see disgust and contempt pretty central to those kinds of conversations. But I also see, do they emote? Because your emotions turn on when something matters to you. And if you're talking about your core beliefs, if you actually do believe them and it's not lip service, then I expect you to emote. I won't tell you which political candidates, but of course, in looking at them and knowing the American landscape, they get questions about religion. And there are some candidates who have, and it doesn't matter which party, but there are some candidates that show a remarkable absence of emoting while they talk about their religious beliefs. We'll leave it at that for the moment.
Interesting. So the difference between disgust and contempt. It seems that disgust is more physiological, right? Because in order to get something out of your system, your body does certain things, and that's, you know, in your face.
Yeah, I call it visceral, but physiological.
Sure,
yes.
So visceral, that makes perfect sense. Whereas contempt has a little bit, because it's more attitudinal, it almost sounds like it's more social, like it is meant to be a social communicator, which emotions are theorized to be general.
Oh, absolutely.
So could you talk a little bit about that? Like, are facial expressions solely social?
No, I think they are a signal to ourselves as well.
Okay.
I mean, I don't think we're nearly as smart as our bodies often are.
Okay.
I mean, I play a fair amount of sports, and I can tell you every best shot I ever made in basketball or tennis just happened.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I played a lot, but they just happened. I think the bodies sometimes alert us to the fact that we're uncomfortable with somebody, we're aversive to that person, and we may half sense it and therefore act on it because our emotions, of course, compel behavior.
Mm-hmm.
But the actual realization of it may come later, like when our friends 2 months later say, "Why were you dating that person?"
Mm-hmm.
And you go, "Oh, you're right. I surrender."
So let's unpack that a little bit. When you say that it is a signal to ourselves,
mm-hmm.
There's. In psychology, of course, there is, you know, the cognitive appraisalists, which say that from cognitive appraisals, whether they're conscious or unconscious, comes forth expression. And then, you know, there's the alternate model, the Jamesian model, I believe, which is pretty much, you know, we don't cry because we're sad. We're sad because we cry. In other words, we're picking up on visceral or physiological cues, and that's where the assessment of the emotion comes from. Are you implying that when we express emotions in our face, when there's not an audience, that we are mindful of that facial expression and that helps us know what our feeling state is?
Well, first of all, when you get into James versus the cognitive scientist, you're into very deep waters. I prefer to go about 5 feet into the pool,
okay.
not down to the 15-feet mark. They're smarter folks than me. I'll let them battle it out.
Mm-hmm.
I'm perfectly happy with the fact that, you know, actions speak louder than words, and emotions give me a good index
mm-hmm.
of where someone's coming from, and that makes my life
more
interesting.
You have a very pragmatic approach to this.
Well,
this is what works.
Well, I just recognize my intellectual limits. I've met really bright people, and I'm smarter than dumb, but there are geniuses who walk the land, and I'm not going to pretend that I'm one of them. So that's that piece of it. Now, what was the rest of your question?
So is with that in mind, regardless
sure.
of the James Lang versus a cognitive appraisalist's component, when expressing emotions, without there being
an audience. I know where you're going. Okay. Yeah. My personal view is that we see dimly. Ourselves mm-hmm. and the world around us.
Many blind spots, you're saying?
Yes, quite honestly. I mean, for instance, I recently filmed a little episode, Dating with Dan, where I watch couples on first dates.
Mm-hmm.
And very amusingly, the first one's a complete disaster. And I debriefed with both of them. And I, as all my female friends said, no surprise there, the guy said the date went very well. The woman said, "I don't even want to see him on the way out of the restaurant."
And you were able to pick up on that immediately?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
So it was a disaster in that the interaction between the couple was a cluster F.
Yes.
Not necessarily that you did a bad job.
Oh, no. No, it was the former, not the latter. But the guy on the date didn't pick this up whatsoever. I mean, not whatsoever. So we essentially lie to ourselves. I mean, what we really want in life is to feel good about ourselves, because that gives us a boost and confidence and, you know, moxie, and we want to attract allies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Freud was a complete idiot. You know, pleasure principle as well as defend yourself.
Yes, somebody else who believes that Freud is an idiot. Okay.
So, I mean, those are two pretty basic things, and so we are very susceptible to being lied to in life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Emperor's New Clothing, when I was in grad school, the professor said one day, you know, what's the greatest book, piece of literature in the world, and, you know, and we got the usual War and Peace and,
mm-hmm.
you know, Henry James, the Golden Bull, and all these sorts of
mm-hmm.
things. And I said, nah, the Emperor's New Clothes. I mean, look at everything from corporate structures to politics to, you know, office politics and in departments and academia. Sorry, Emperor's New Clothing.
Mm.
We don't want to know the truth. We want the truth if it's really nice and positive.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we do not want the truth.
And that's what kind of contributes to, you know, the confirmation bias.
Oh, absolutely.
The disconfirmation bias.
And that's why you have all sorts of problems in the world. I don't remember what story it is in the Bible, but I believe there's a story in the Bible where the king has 400 advisors. 399 of them tell him the glad-handing semi-truth. Mm-hmm. One guy tells him the truth, he goes to prison.
that's what you get for telling the truth.
Yeah,
right?
I mean, take the scandal on Wall Street, you know, the Great Recession. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, they did a survey, and the overriding conclusion as to why these brainy people missed it was enforced optimism. Mm. That was their two-word answer. Yeah, if you boil it down.
Yeah, so we like to lie to ourselves.
I'm afraid so.
We have blind spots.
Absolutely.
And because the gestalt of emotion, which involves appraisal, regardless of whether it comes or post physiology, and it includes the physiology having to do with gestures and posture and facial expressions specifically.
But the gestures can be faked far more easily.
Is that right?
Absolutely. I'm actually at work on something involving... Well, I've done a lot of analysis work for CNN and Fox and MSNBC and newspapers on the presidential debates, for instance, and the campaigns. So the hand gestures get deployed for a purpose, you know. Mm-hmm. After 1976, you pretty much will not see a presidential debate when anyone does a fist.
Mm-hmm.
Because they decided, we should really take
that
out.
That's like the famous Bill Clinton.
Yeah, well, he'll do the semi-fist. You know, mm-hmm. I want to look purposeful. But I don't want to do the karate chop. I don't want to do the fist. All those things got retired.
And there's a lot of open hand, like pleading gestures.
Oh, yeah, but not too pleading. You don't want to look like you're a beggar. You know, mm-hmm. I am trying to get to the White House after all. Mm-hmm. So there are some limits here. But, you know, that's what you're going to get a lot more of, and you're not going to get these sorts of things. So those things can get consciously deployed. Believe me, they all have body language coaches.
Mm-hmm.
But on the face, because of that spontaneity, where the face is the only place in the body where the muscles attach right to the skin,
mm-hmm.
that gives me the opportunity to pick up those unintentional interruptions. They may be brief, they may be squelched, but they tell me where the person actually comes from. Mm.
Well, and it's becoming so popular in politics now that I think that, you know, some of the channels, Fox or CNN, after a debate, they'll have somebody who is like a body language expert, if you will.
They'll usually take the body language stuff because it's grosser and more easily followed by the home audience.
Mm-hmm.
But I've read some of the books and literature so on by these people. Sorry, but it's fairly appalling, the state of the supposed art.
Interesting. So body language is what you would say is like barely touching the tip of the iceberg, whereas facial expressions is like where the rubber hits the road?
Facial coding has been codified by Ekman in a way that cannot be codified when we get to body language.
Mm-hmm.
It's affected by gender. It's affected by culture. I mean, a hand gesture that will get you killed in Sicily is benign in Belgium. You know, so you really have to be very careful. And women sit and move by and large differently than guys do. I mean, you see the guy who sprawls like an ape with his legs spread. You'll see that. You go to any mall, I promise you, you'll see some guy slump waiting for his wife or girlfriend to come out of the store. He's on the bench mm-hmm. outside. You don't have to be in the store for an hour at Christmas time without seeing that. You can go weeks without seeing a woman who would sit that way.
Wow, that's interesting. Now, I think that I've pretty much covered everything that I was interested in asking you about. So thank you very much once again
Absolutely.
For carving out a little bit of time
Sure.
to chew the fat with me about these things. I have a feeling we could talk more, but it would just be talk about digressions. We would just start
Okay.
riffing about nonsense.
I
nonsense to them.
Sure. I had a great
Fun
time.
Fun to us.
I had a great time. Thank you
very much.
Sure. Matt.